All right, so for this week's project, we're going to be taking a look at this beautiful old Sony CDPX33ES compact disc player. Unit was made in 1990, according to the label in the back of it. And the customer's complaint is he's saying there's some sort of distortion in one channel of it. And of course, nothing really comes to mind right off the top here. So we'll have to get it hooked up and see if we can duplicate what he's talking about. Perhaps that problem is in his receiver or in his preamp and not really in the CD player. I didn't think to ask him if that would have been an issue showing up in other sources rather than just the CD player. But as always, we'll come in, we'll have a look at the buttons on the unit, see what they provided for us. One notable thing is when I picked this up, it is a very heavy unit, and so that leads me to wonder, if we open the lid up, are we going to have two power supplies inside this unit, or are we going to have a lid that is heavily padded with some type of metal plate that assists with sound dampening? But we'll find all that out once we get it opened up. Our intro music this week, we're listening to the 1986 Emerson, Lake & Powell self-titled album. I believe this would have been the time Carl Palmer was doing the drumming for Asia. And so Cozy Powell comes in and does not miss a beat, so to speak. They make a really nice album here. So we're going to listen to their single from this, Touch and Go, hear a little bit of this, and then we'll get started on the Sony. So we're going to pick back up. We'll have a look at our front panel buttons here. Of course, you're going to get from back in this time a hard power switch. Right below it, they're going to give you the timer play switch just in case you want to set it up to take off and start playing on its own once the power is restored to the unit. And there's an IR window below that. Of course, it is a remote controlled unit. And this one does have aluminum tray in it. And there's a display for giving you all the information about your disc that you're playing. Right here we have our open and close button. And the buttons that we have over here, it looks like display mode. That probably basically just, you know, changes how it displays the information about the disc. And the one next to it, the time and memo button here, is probably just gives you the options for how it does count the time, whether it counts up or counts down. Across these, we've got repeat, fader, which is a cool feature, check, clear, and then the transport controls of stop, pause, play, and yeah, over to the right here, the track search, forward and reverse, and then of course the in-track search, you know, advance the time of the particular song you're listening to. And the few buttons here seem to correspond to some type of programming options, file, erase. This one has a greater 20 button on it and multi-program. And of course, this button corresponds to these here. And this is one of my favorite features of any CD player, direct track entry. So it doesn't matter what song you want, and you can just push that button, track number 12, and it'll go right to number 12 without you having to sit there and keep pressing up. Very cool feature. And this one, they even give you all the buttons all the way to 20. And if you need more than 20, you just do 20 plus 7 if the disc would have 27 tracks on it. Up here we have continue, the play mode, continue, shuffle, program, and then C index. Is that C? Is that what that is? Yeah, C index. I'm not sure what that's all about. I have to look that up in the manual. You get your line out control, which is basically a motorized volume control. There is a motor on the back of that, and the remote control that comes with the unit from the factory will adjust that. And that corresponds, of course, to the variable RCA jacks in the back of the unit. And then there's some few other buttons here that obviously pertain to programming. We have file recall, peak search, very cool feature there. It'll go ahead and scan the entire disc, looking for the exact highest peak of music. That way, if you're recording onto a tape, you can set your record levels accordingly. And then we have edit, time fade, time set, and level file. They do give you a nice quarter inch headphone jack here. Let's go ahead and jump up. I went ahead and removed the lid from the unit, which, by the way, my guess was correct. There is a metal plate kind of glued into the top of this. I don't know how well I can pick that up on the camera, but let's see here. Yeah, they kind of glued some type of piece of metal to this to give it damp sound dampening and add some weight to it, which I don't know if that's to assist in vibration or what. And they apparently did the same thing on the bottom because it's still pretty heavy even with that removed. We'll take a look first at the mechanism. This does use a very rare direct drive sled motor for the optical pickup, and this optical pickup is one that they didn't use a lot once they got past this series. I don't remember them using that anymore. They went to the KSS 210 and 212 and all that series, but this one is very cool. Got that direct drive sled, so you don't have to worry about a motor wearing out there. But the spindle motor, they still use just a standard Mabuchi spindle motor for spinning the disc up. Nice size transformer for the power supply. And then this is where it gets a little weird. We've got the power supply over here, all the components, and you'll notice that all of these capacitors are either black or brown. Then we get over to this section, and one of the things that I noticed right off the get-go when I removed the lid from this is the unescapable odor of capacitor cancer. And after getting my magnifier down here and taking a closer look at some of these, every single one of these red, looks like they're Elna Duralex or something like that, capacitors, every one of them that's red is leaking. There's material coming out of the leads, and I don't know if I'll be able to pick it up on the camera, but we'll try here. Let's see. Maybe with the proper light. Let's see. Yeah, you can see, and there's a smell to this thing. Now, let's see, I lost my place. There we go. Yeah, there's a smell to it. It's got kind of a stinky odor to it. And I would imagine that this is probably a contributing factor, if not the factor, of the audio problem that he's having. We'll have to hook it up and see what it sounds like, but all these capacitors are right here in this section, in the audio section of this unit. And there's tons of other capacitors here, but none of them are these. These are all red, and they all seem to be condensed right here in the audio section. Although I did see a couple of larger ones over here in the power supply section, and then there's a couple branded with that Duralex name right here, but I don't know whether they're leaking or not. But I'll tell you what, let's go ahead and I'm going to get the camera set up in the tripod, and we'll go ahead and dump a line from the fixed output into the mixer, and we'll put a disc in it and we'll see what it will do. I would imagine that since the power supply doesn't look like it has any leaking caps in it, it should turn on and work, but we'll find out what he's talking about when it comes to the audio. So give me a second for that and we'll come back. All right, so as we come back in, went ahead and got power hooked up to the unit. Brought a line from the fixed RCA outputs over to the mixer so we can hear what's going on with the audio. And as soon as I put a disc in, it spun over and read the table of contents immediately. There was no hesitation whatsoever with this part of it. So I think we'll go ahead and skip ahead to track 4 on this disc, one of my favorite Blue Oyster Cult songs. Oh, and there's no question, I hear something. Looks like right channel. Let's go ahead and isolate that away. Let's get rid of the left channel now, just the right. I'm gonna turn it up a little bit in the mixer. And so that must be exactly what he's talking about. We got one channel that worked fine. And then we have a distorted, staticky right channel. So if I had to guess, well, clearly there's something going on with all the leaking capacitors. I think one thing we should probably do though, let's pull the bottom of the unit off and make sure there's no trace damage underneath the bottom. And just to confirm that this is definitely where we're at and there's no other problems that we're aware of, I want to see if we can narrow it down to which one of those is causing the problem with that channel. And we'll jump one in and see if we can get the right channel restored. But he's looking at a pretty good repair for this. There's a lot of capacitors there that's gonna need to be replaced, about 20 that I counted, if we change all the ones under that. I was calling them Duralex, but I think it's Durorex capacitors. So if we change all of those, there's about 20 of them, maybe 22, so. I'm gonna go ahead and pull the bottom of the unit off of it. And then from that point, we'll see if we had any bottom coil trace damage. If not, then we'll look for the one that's actually causing this issue and see if we can get the right channel working just by jumping one in. All right, so we're gonna pick back up and this is gonna be day 2. And I was able to change a couple of these out just enough to get the rest of these ooey gooey leaking capacitors to charge up enough just to get it working. About 80% of the distortion is gone out of the channel when you first turn it on. If it's been off for a while, then it takes a little bit, a couple of seconds for it to dissipate. But for the most part, it is working just fine. Let's go ahead and we'll disconnect the left channel. The right channel was the one we were having problems with. So we'll pull that one out. Let's fire it up a little bit here. All right, and I think that at this point, everything's kind of going to be on hold until I speak with the customer. He's going to have a decision to make here. This is going to be a fairly big job. There's about 22 capacitors in this that's going to need to be changed. If you are a big internet capacitor changer, I would suggest you find every one of these that is in this series, which apparently is a 33ES, a 55ES, and a 77ES. Get yourself a bulk load of capacitors and you can go crazy on one of these things because there's quite a few caps that's going to need to be changed. There is some damage on the other side of the board. Let's go ahead and switch it off. One thing you won't be able to see with this camera, it just won't zoom in far enough, but I mopped up all of that material off the board with numerous cotton swabs. It had gotten down into the holes of these transistors here and it took me a little time to get it mopped up, but there is some trace damage on the other side. It's not completely corroded away, but it is still worthy of noting. All this dark area right here, this trace, that used to be green, but now it's black because all that material got leaked down through the solder and got into the trace and started eating away the trace. And there's a few pins on that IC that's going to need to be touched up. And then there's a surface mount IC here that I actually had to mop up a bunch of that material off of. It was pretty much, you can't see it here, but under magnification, there was a lot of liquid hanging out in this area. So got it all cleaned up. And it is working. Well, as we bring this one to a close, I want to thank everyone for checking out the video this week. And I know we've had some new people stop by, checking out the channel, got a few more subscribers. So appreciate your time as well, looking at these videos. Hopefully one of these may have helped you in something that you're repairing, or at least give you a little bit of guidance in the right direction. And as for this one, I'd be very surprised if the customer doesn't repair this. This is a very, very nice CD player. And looking at a couple dozen capacitors being changed, also gonna go ahead and change out the tray belt. And we'll have to mop up all that moisture on the top side of the board, repair the trace on the bottom side of the board. So it's probably looking at a couple $100 or so, but I'd be surprised if he doesn't get this repaired. Well, again, thank you very much. Appreciate you checking out the videos. And until next week. And this one we'll probably pick back up on in a couple of weeks or so. If he does go ahead with the repair, we'll have to order up some parts, get some quality replacements for all those caps. But definitely be back next week with something different. And until then, we'll listen to a little Honeymoon Suite on the way out the door. I believe this was from The Big Prize.